We've learned about uniform flow and we've learned about doublet flow. Those are two different potential flows that both satisfy Laplace's equation. And now we're going to find that if we combine those, we can create the flow field that would represent the flow around a circular cylinder. So what we're going to do is take the velocity potential from the uniform flow and add it to the velocity potential of the doublet flow, and that is going to give us the velocity flow around a circular cylinder. So let's look at what that would look like. Is our free stream velocity, and now we're going to add that to a doublet, and so let's just draw a doublet here. So we've got y and x, and we'll put a doublet right there at the center, and so that will create a flow field that looks like this. And it has a direction and a magnitude of kappa, and the free stream velocity has a magnitude of V infinity. Okay, so these are our two potential flows that we're going to add together. And there's going to be a stagnation point on the left-hand side here, as that flow from that's coming out of that doublet to the left at some point is going to be equivalent to the free stream velocity. And so that will make a stagnation point. And if we were to follow the streamline around, we'd find that it would create a perfect circle, something like this. And now if we add the two together, we're going to find that these streamlines from the free stream will never cross that boundary, and we'll get flow over a cylinder. It'll look something like that. Okay, so there's some interesting things we can do with this. The first one is let's find where that stagnation point is, and we'll do that by looking at these velocities here. Once we add these two velocity fields together, we want to find the point in the flow where these two sum to give us zero. So let's start in the z direction first. That's really easy. All the flow in the z direction is zero. So then let's look in the theta hat direction, and we find that both of these have a sine theta in them. And so if the sine of theta is zero, then the velocity in the theta hat direction will be zero. So that is true. Let's see, these two stagnation points here occur at theta equals zero and pi. So those are our stagnation points. Okay, so theta is either zero or pi. That gives us zero in the theta direction. And now let's look at the velocity in the r hat direction. So let's take the velocity from the uniform flow, which is v infinity cosine of theta, and add it to the velocity from the doublet flow, which is minus kappa over 2 pi cosine of theta over r squared, and we're saying that that has to be equal to zero. Now the cosine theta actually cancels out of this equation, but if we plugged in the zero or the pi, we'd just get negative one or one, but I'm just gonna cross those out because they're gonna cancel out here, and we're left with let's solve for V infinity equals kappa over 2 pi r squared. And we can actually solve that to give r squared is equal to kappa over 2 pi V infinity. Okay, So this is interesting because it says that the location of that stagnation point, the R location, And remember, r is measured out from the center here. The r location, or the radius of that stagnation point, is proportional to kappa. So if kappa gets larger, then r will also get larger, right? So that the radius of that cylinder will increase. And it's inversely proportional to V infinity. So if the velocity, the free stream velocity gets larger, then the radius or the radial location of that stagnation point will decrease. So actually, this equation tells us, because that stagnation point lies on the surface of that cylinder, it actually tells us the exact radius of that cylinder, which is equal to the square root of kappa over 2 pi V infinity. Okay, so this is the radius of our cylinder. And again, it's proportional to the square root of kappa and inversely proportional to the square root of V infinity. So now let's take these equations. We're gonna take this guy and this guy and add them together. And instead of leaving things in terms of kappa, I'm actually going to swap out all of the kappa values for the radius. So we get phi of r theta is equal to V infinity times r plus capital R squared over r cosine theta. And then if we take the gradient of that and get the velocity vector, it's equal to V infinity times 1 minus capital R squared over little r squared cosine of theta, and that's in the r hat direction, minus V infinity 1 plus capital R squared over little r squared in the sine times sine theta in the theta hat direction, and then plus 0 in the z hat direction. Okay, so this is the velocity potential and the velocity vector, or the velocity flow field for the flow around a circular cylinder. Now, these equations can be used to find the velocity at any point in the flow, including inside of the cylinder if we wanted to. But we generally don't care about the velocity field inside of the cylinder. We're trying to look at the velocity flow external to the cylinder. And because no mass crosses this streamline here, which represents the external geometry, then that streamline will be the external geometry because no mass crosses that. And so these equations here can be used to find the velocity at any point in this flow field around this geometry, and it depends, or here we've written it in terms of r, instead of kappa, instead of looking at the magnitude of this doublet here, we can instead just say we can choose the radius of the cylinder and use this equation here, and not have to solve for kappa. We could solve for kappa if we wanted to, using these equations down here, that relates the radius of the cylinder to the strength of that doublet.